Revising what we did in the last lecture briefly, what we did was to start with the principle that delta of integral ds should be equal to 0, where ds is written with a non-trivial metric such that ds square is gab dxa dxb. And we obtained the equations of motion for that, for this particle moving in this non-trivial metric. And we found that that equation could be written in the following form: duA by ds plus gamma A, let us say BC, UB, UC equal to 0. Okay. And this also allowed us to define a covariant derivative, the concept of a covariant derivative, and that was defined by taking this equation to be just, let us say, UB of DB of UA equal to 0, with the understanding that DB of UA stands for ordinary derivative of UA plus a correction term, which is gamma A B C UC. Then I explained to you how this concept of covariant derivative can be extended, first for covariant indices and then for mixed indices and several indices. So this is only with practice you will get the feel for that, but essentially this is what is going on. Now I want to make a series of comments about this after having done this mathematics before we proceed further to physics. The next step is curvature, but we will come to that in a moment. And I have also told you that this gamma CAB comes from the fact that the basis vectors in either curved spacetime or in curvilinear coordinate system are not parallel to each other and they keep changing from point to point. We gave an alternate definition of this gamma in terms of the rule dA of EB is some gamma BAC EC. I also mentioned, and let me emphasize it again, that here A stands for a space-time index, while the B on this EB tells you which vector we are talking about. That is why I have put a vector symbol there. Okay? And this is also the same thing. This quantity should be a vector. Because it is a vector, it can be expanded in the basis itself, and that defines these quantities. And we also wrote down the expression for the gammas in terms of the metric, which we will keep requiring and I will write down whenever we need. But we had an understanding of that. And we also said the covariant derivative of the metric should vanish. All this has been covered, and I explained to you where this comes from. Because the basis vectors are changing, you need to correct for the rotation of the basis vectors by this term. Okay. Now let us try to interpret what we have done in several ways. First of all, this gives you an interpretation that a curve which satisfies this equation, in which of course you could have written UA itself as some dxa by ds, where xa of s is the trajectory of the particle. So that curve xa of s which you obtain from this is the one which minimizes this length. Now if we have been working with a space time, or space rather, in which this ds is made out of gabs which are all positive definite, like your normal three dimensional space, then this is what one would have called a geodesic, and we will use the same terminology in space-time as well. It is a curve of least length. So you can take the metric for a sphere, calculate this, and you should get great circles as the answer to that. Even if you take the metric in polar coordinates in a sheet of paper and do this, you should end up getting straight lines written in polar coordinates. Okay? These are good exercises to try them out. So this is one way of defining a straight line. That is, you take two points on the manifold and the curve of least length connecting these two is a straight line. And obviously in order to define the length, you need the notion of a metric. Metric essentially gives you the notion of the length. But there is another way of thinking about a straight line. I explained that to you previously. Straight line is the one when you go straight. What do you mean by that is that if you take a curve and you take a tangent vector to the curve, then along the direction of the tangent vector, the vector should not change, right? So if you take an arc of a circle and you take a tangent vector and you move in this direction, if you come here, the tangent to the curve does not match with the new point which you reach by moving straight, okay? So how do you generalize that notion? That is what is given here. This quantity within the bracket can be interpreted as the directional derivative of A along B, along the B direction. Now you are dotting it with UB, which means that you are looking at the directional derivative in the direction of the vector itself. For example, in three dimension, this would sort of go to something like V dot del acting on V is equal to 0. If you have done a little bit of fluid mechanics, you would recognize this as a kind of an acceleration term in fluid mechanics, and that is precisely what is happening here. So this tells you that V dot del defines for you a direction in which you want to calculate the rate of change, and that direction itself is equal to the vector, the direction of the vector itself, and it is not changing there. That is a very nice notion of a straight line. In order to do this, I only need to give you gammas. So I told you that an affine manifold is something in which gammas are defined, but a metric may or may not exist. And then in an affine manifold, if the gammas are given for you, you can write this down. So you can define a geodesic using just Christoffel symbols, or you can define a geodesic using a metric by defining the length. So there are two ways of defining the curve of least length, or a straight line, better still, a straight line in a curved manifold. A straight line can be defined as a curve of least length between the two points, or you can think of straight line as something which is going straight. The fact that these two definitions should match, or our desire that these two definitions should match, is encoded in the rule that the covariant derivative of a metric is equal to 0. That gives you a connection between the metric and the Christoffel symbols, which we had already written down in the previous lecture. Okay. Now I want to go further and obtain several further results. The first result I want to know or obtain is how gammas transform, okay. This I will not do, I am going to leave it as an assignment because it is completely straightforward. The way you proceed is the following. You know that this gamma ABCD or ABCs is defined as half G A sum index K. The idea is you take this A and put a K to that, which means you are mentally lowering the K with a comma. That K index object should come with a minus sign. So this is dK of remaining, which is GBZ. Rest of it goes by just permutation. GKC plus DC of GKB. Okay, this is the definition of gamma, and we know how G's transform. G's transform as G bar or G prime, let us say IK, is equal to, I will write it as L I prime A, L K prime B, GAB. These are the quantities which are defined for a curvilinear coordinate transformation as dxa by dxi prime, okay. Remember, this was very first. I used to write it like this, but I am just using L to simplify the notation. In the Lorentz transformation also, this is exactly what we did. The only difference between Lorentz transformation and an arbitrary curvilinear transformation is now these are functions of space itself. And you can have an inversion of this with the primes going on top, that will be written with the upper index. This is why I like to put the prime on the indices, then it is clear which way these things go, but you can always keep that in mind. So since you know how they transform, and since you know how these derivatives transform, you can work the whole thing through and calculate how the gammas transform. Okay, that is why it, since it is straightforward but tedious, I am not doing it. But the answer is the following. What you will get is this, I am going to write in terms of the primed quantities. First you take a gamma I j k in prime coordinate and transform it as though it is a tensor. Okay. So that will be this I prime should go to A. So you put a L A and an I prime. Then you put a L J prime and a B and an L and a K prime and a C. If this is all there is to it, it would have been a tensor, but there is an additional term. So the additional term is given by this. It involves one derivative of whatever is left here. So let me write it as dB of L A prime C. Now instead of A prime, let me call it some K prime C. Then that has to be taken away. So you put a K prime here and a A. Okay, this is the full transformation. Now this term is uninteresting. This just tells you that if gamma Christoffel symbols were tensors, you just transform it like that. But let us stare at this term. This term stands in detail for dxa by dxk prime. This quantity is, there is already a d by dB, d square xk prime with respect to dxb dxc. This is the important term. What it tells you is that if I give you a transformation rule where I have given you xk prime as some functions of x, okay, then you are taking the second derivative of that k prime with respect to b and c. So if they have been linear transformations, first derivative would have given you a constant, second derivative would have given you a zero. So under linear transformations or Lorentz transformation, they behave like tensors. Of course, under Lorentz transformations, if a global Lorentz prime is available, you could have chosen a Cartesian coordinate system with these things vanishing. Therefore, it will vanish under any Lorentz transformation. This is why we never bothered about it in special relativity. What this tells you also, that if you go from a frame in which Christoffel symbols are zero, like in two-dimensional flat sheet of paper in Cartesian coordinates, xy coordinates, but you go from xy to r theta coordinates. These transformations now tell you how you go from xy to r theta coordinate, which are not linear transformation, you will pick up this term. And in fact, this will be the only term left for the gammas. So this immediately tells you how you can compute the gammas in polar coordinates. So this is going to be again an assignment question, so you can try it out. You go from xy coordinates to r theta coordinates and you compute gammas in different ways and make sure all of them make sense. One way is to sort of minimize this, the interval in polar coordinates, and then read off the gammas. Another way is to make the coordinate transformation and obtain that, and yet another way is to write down the metric and then calculate this. All of them should give you the same thing, which it would, but it is a good way to gain some practice on Christoffel symbols. So this is how they transform, and this also tells you that it is not a tensor. There is an extra piece term which comes up. I also mentioned to you long back that this is not really part of the course, it is more for a cultural comment, that if you are looking at gauge theories, then these gammas will be replaced by what is known as gauge potentials. So they will be thought of as gamma B as a matrix in a given representation with two internal indices A and C. I also told you in that context B will go 0, 1, 2, 3, but A and C can go 1 to n. Okay. Now if you look at the structure of this, you will find that there are these two indices in this. which is going to essentially give you the matching between the primed and unprimed coordinates, and they will give you something like a gauge transformation. That is, this will again come out as matrices. So you will have something like an M inverse DM kind of a term, because you think of this and this as inverses of each other. So it is like an M inverse DM kind of a transformation, extra transformation term, which will come about. So this is how in gauge theories the gauge potentials transform, and these would have been thought of as some gauge transformations. Okay, fine. So I have explained to you how these things transform, using which you can also introduce the locally inertial coordinate system which we talked about long back. In the first lecture on curved space time, I told you that around any given event, you can choose coordinates in such a way that the metric becomes eta ab. And the first derivatives of the metric vanish. Now, the first derivatives of a metric vanish means all these will go, Christoffel symbols will vanish. So, what you are asking is that you are given a given, you are given some metric in some coordinate system. You have to find a coordinate transformation. In the original metric, there are some gammas. So, you want this entire term to be equal to 0. Okay? You can't do it everywhere, but around an event you can do, because we did that Taylor expansion thing. So essentially this term has to match this, and it is fairly easy to write down what you need to do for that. That transformation is given by this. You take xi prime to be equal to xi plus half gamma I KL at the origin XK XL. What it means is the following. You have an event at which you want to make the Christoffel symbols vanish. You go to that event and first just do a translation in the coordinates, which you can always do, so that it becomes the origin. That is just for convenience. So the coordinates, if you go for an infinitesimal region from that, xi tell you to the first order the coordinates around that region in the neighborhood of the origin. Then you introduce an xi prime such that there is a quadratic term here which is evaluated with this di, the gamma ikl evaluated at the origin coming as coefficient. You can immediately see that this term will take care of producing exactly what is needed, and all the other matrices will become unity at the origin. Because if you take the dxi prime by dxj, this will give you unity. This will give you a term which is linear in x. When x goes to 0, they will vanish. As a result of which, it will exactly cancel out whatever need to be cancelled out, and you will end up getting the correct result. Okay? Is that fine? So when people talk about a locally inertial frame or a point at which the derivatives of the metric vanish, the explicit construction for this is you choose what you are given some frame, then you choose a coordinate transformation of this kind, and that will make the gammas vanish at that point. If gammas, all the gammas vanish, derivatives will vanish and vice versa. So this is an explicit construction for constructing a coordinate system in which our original counting is implemented. Okay, fine. Now let me go back to the next comment. This is all a series of comments, but all of them are arising out of what we have done in the mathematics. Now I want to go and look at this equation a little bit more closely. This equation, if I write it in terms of the coordinates itself, it is given by d square xi by ds square plus gamma I kl dxk by ds dxl by ds equal to 0. But in writing this equation, we made a choice that ds is the proper time of the particle. Because if you remember, we started with ds square. Then when we did the delta, at some place, we said that ds is the proper time and defined the four velocity. Actually, that is a slightly overly restrictive way of looking at the geodesic equation. So, I want to explain to you what it means. Suppose you are given a curve xi of s. What is real for you is the curve, because in the given space time, suppose I have a space coordinate and a time coordinate, this is space, this is time, some arbitrary coordinate, and I have a curve like this. And at any given point, I can define a tangent vector which is ui. This curve has a parameter s, this could be s is equal to 0, this could be s is equal to 3, etc. What is real is this curve, not the parameterization. So, from s, I can choose some other parameter and the curve will remain the same curve. So, I am interested in looking at transformations of this equation under a transformation s is equal to some function of lambda, where lambda is a new parameter giving the curve. So, given that, I can write d by ds as d by d lambda into d lambda by ds. D lambda by ds is 1 upon ds by d lambda, which is your f prime, right. So, using this, I want to transform this equation and see what happens. I originally have the equation in terms of my proper time, but now I am introducing some other parameter. So, let us see what happens. First, I will have here d by ds will go into 1 upon f prime d by d lambda. Let me forget that 1 upon f prime for a minute and write d by d lambda. Then another d by ds, that will become 1 upon f prime dxi by d lambda plus there is a gamma ikl. Then there is a dxk by ds. So, that is going to pick up a 1 upon f prime d by d lambda, that f prime and the f prime I forgot here goes away. So, that gives me dxk by d lambda. Then the next one will give me an extra f prime. So, let me put it there, dxl by d lambda equal to 0. Right. Now, I want to expand this term out. This term is going to give me first a 1 upon f prime d square xi by d lambda square. That is fine, because that and this term together is going to give me a nice geodesic equation, but there is an extra term. So, that extra term is going to be dxi by d lambda, which let me again call ui. Maybe I shouldn't call ui, because ui we have reserved for dxi by ds. So, let me write it as dxi by d lambda. Okay. Then I have to take this derivative, that is going to give me minus 1 upon f prime square and an f double prime, correct. So, this f prime and one of these f primes I can cancel out and I can move this to the right hand side. All clear? Okay. Therefore, this is equal to, this will give me d square xi by d lambda square plus gamma I kl dxi by d lambda, sorry, dxk by d lambda, dxl by d lambda. This is fine, and on the right hand side, I am going to pick up this extra term, 1 f prime has gone. So, that is, you are left with f double prime by f prime dxi by d lambda. Okay. it's actually a good time to call this dxi by d lambda something. So, since I did not want to use the word ui, I will call it some vi. So, what this tells you is that if I take that as vi, the left hand side is some vb db of vi. This is equal to f double prime by f prime vi. Let us ask what this means, because the left hand side is just the standard geodesic operator. So, that is covariant derivative of vi with respect to vb dotted with vb. I mean, it is just this thing, right, with u being replaced by v, where this quantity is what I am calling v. This is vl dxl by d lambda now. Okay. It is essentially the four velocity, but now we are using the parameterization lambda, which is not a proper term. That is the only thing. So, let us make sure you understood what is going on. We start with the geodesic equation with the proper time, then we just made a transformation that this proper time is some function of some other arbitrary parameter lambda. Then we carried through the differentiations in that, and we found that for an arbitrary parameterization, the equation, geodesic equation, changes into this form and picks up an extra term on the right hand side. Again, I am emphasizing this because this is not usually done in the textbook. Lendo does not do it, for example, but it is important. Okay. There are several conclusions you can obtain from this. The first thing is that we want to understand that it is still a geodesic equation. Okay. Of course, one way you can say is that we started with a geodesic equation, just did a bit of calculus, and that only changes this s to lambda, and geodesic will not change. The curve is not going to change because I change the parameter. But there is also a nice physical way of thinking about this. Originally, we had ui as the tangent vector with respect to the proper time. Now, the tangent vectors are vi with respect to some other parameter, right? What do you mean by a particle which is not accelerated? Just think about it physically. If you go to the instantaneous rest prime of the particle, as the particle is moving, suppose you go to a frame where the velocity vector is along the time direction, you go to an instantaneous, make a Lorentz transformation, go to an instantaneous rest prime, the spatial components of the acceleration has to vanish. Because remember that in the instantaneous rest prime, you have the ui ai equals 0 kind of a condition, and we lose information about the spatial components, and that we want to vanish. Then you are fine. That is precisely what this is. Because if you go to the instantaneous rest prime, in the instantaneous rest prime, there are no spatial components here, right? This is the generalized acceleration. Why is this the generalized acceleration? Let us again spend a little moment to think about this. This entire term came out of this, which is a generalization of d square xi by d lambda square. This term vanishing is the condition for a free particle motion. Okay. So, this is the generalized acceleration or a covariant acceleration in a curved space time, and that acceleration has no spatial components in the frame in which the instantaneous velocity vector has only time component. So, as long as on the right hand side you throw in anything which is proportional to ui with an arbitrary function here, you should still be talking about a geodesic equation. So, you could have guessed it, that is what I am saying. That when you write down this equation, one could have said that look, if the right hand side has a term which is proportional to ua, it should still be a geodesic equation, because we know that it has no spatial acceleration in the rest frame. And that is precisely what happened. It goes both ways. If somebody gives you on the right hand side something with some k of lambda times ua, then you can write that k of lambda to be equal to this and integrate that equation to find f. That will tell you what reparameterization has taken place. Okay. That is correct. Yeah, vi has v0, v1, v2, v3. In the rest frame, instantaneous rest frame, by definition of instantaneous rest prime, v0 is 1, v1, v2, v3 is 0. Therefore, if in the instantaneous rest prime I write down this equation, the alpha components of the left hand side will vanish. This will not happen for anything other than when you add purely some quantity with whose special components vanishes in the restraint. Okay, that is why some other crazy transformation will not preserve the geodesic form. Okay. It also tells you one more thing. If f double prime was 0, your geodesic equation does not change. Now, f double prime 0 means you are talking about a transformation which is linear. So, the S is defined only with respect to a linear transformation. S can go to lambda, which is alpha S plus beta. That is obvious even from the geodesic equation, because if you scale it by translation, does not matter because only derivatives appear there. So, beta does not matter. Alpha will cancel out because there are 2 S's in this and there are 2 DS's in this. So, they cancel out. Therefore, you can do this transformation and get the same result. It also ties in with this equation, because in this, when you write DS, you are going to take a square root. I could have divided this by any d lambda here, that would have given me 2 d lambdas, and then you multiply by a d lambda and you are through, because that is a good variational principle. And I did not have to say that that d lambda should be equal to the proper time. It was convenient to work with the proper time, but it is not necessary. This is the way geodesics are interpreted in general relativity, in a slightly more general sense than we originally derived. The reason being, normally when you talk about geodesics, you have a physical idea back of mind, like a particle moving, etc. But in a manifold, you can think of a geodesic which is either space-like or time-like or null. Okay. Now, what do I mean by that? Suppose I am given a geodesic, then you take the tangent vector to the geodesic, that is like a velocity, and you compute UA, UA, and you ask whether it is positive, negative or 0. If it is positive, then it is time like, a material particle can go on that. If it is 0, it is null and only photons can travel along, or massless particles can travel along that. If it is negative, it is space like, no known particles can travel along that, but you can still think of a space like geodesic connecting 2 points in the space time. It is a mathematically well defined notion. Okay. This is the reason I did not put an m when I started with this work. Because even when m is equal to 0 limit, the variation is well defined. Ds could be 0, I do not care, because delta ds is what I am interested in. The numerical value of the action is irrelevant, its variation is non-trivial, and that is what we work out. So, in general, you could have started with a vector, for example, a vector, let us say Ka, such that Ka, Ka is equal to 0, this is a null vector, which could be a tangent vector to a trajectory of a photon, and we will keep working with that later on, satisfying, let us say, KB DB of KA equal to 0. These two together would give you a null geodesic. Okay. While for a material particle, this will be equal to some m square or whatever, 1 in our normalization. Yeah.
So, if you have a quadratic transformation,
right. No, this equation is always a geodesic, whatever is the transformation. Because we started with this equation, which is a geodesic, and made a transformation. What I am trying to emphasize is that if you see an equation which is not equal to 0 here, but something times ui, that is still geodesic equation, except that that fellow is not using proper time as the parameter. Okay. So, every once in a while you will get an equation like this, and you should not think that it is a non-geodesic motion. It is still geodesic motion, but with a different parameterization. That is why I spent time to derive this form. So, this is the most general form of a geodesic equation, because we have written down the geodesic and made an arbitrary transformation. That is all the freedom we are left with, because coordinate transformation do not change anything. Okay. So, that is the point. It is still a geodesic even with a quadratic transformation, but right hand side will be non-zero. If it is linear, right hand side will go to 0. Okay. So, you can also ask the following question. This geodesic equation is given to you. What is the most general transformation which retains its form? First, xi going to arbitrary xi prime retains its form. Lambda going to alpha lambda, I mean s going to alpha s plus beta retains its form. This exhausts the whole thing. So, all the parameters in which the geodesic equation retains this form are called affine parameters. So, you say that this geodesic equation is affinely parametrized. Now, if you change the parameterization, in general you will end up getting this, which is not an affinely parameterized equation, but it is still a geodesic equation. Is that clear? Okay. So, this is the definition of a null geodesic which I told you. Now, the reason I brought up here null geodesic here is because you can never use proper time for a null geodesic, because ds along that path vanishes. So, you cannot sort of say that there is a photon moving along this thing and you are using ds. So, the only way you can define null geodesic in a space time is by using these two equations. You say that give me a vector field Ka such that this is 0 everywhere and this is 0. Okay. Then you will ask, okay, how do I get that curve? You will say use any parameterization you like. You can use an affine parameterization in which this will be equal to 0. You can use a non-affine parameter where this can be non-zero.
But in writing that del B, I have already used one parameterization.
Right? In del B?
Yeah.
Not, no. Because del B involves derivatives with respect to space-time points.
Okay.
That is why it is a little bit clever. In writing Ka in terms of a curve, you need a parameterization, but not in del B. See, the del B KB stands for d by d lambda. So, you have to tell me what lambda is before I can do that. Del B alone does not require anything. What is del B? Del B is this operator. It is ordinary derivative plus this. If you give me any vector, I can calculate this. I do not need the parameterization. But in order to write KB, you can very cleverly just give me the vector everywhere. That is in fact a very nice way of doing things. Do not think in terms of curves. Give me a vector field. One vector at every point which satisfies both these conditions, right? Then there is a then you have a null geodesic vector field. Okay? These are the tangent vectors to the null geodesics. What I can now do is to define what is known as the integral curves to a vector field. What it means is a very simple concept. You are given a series of vectors, let us say, some sensible set of vectors at every point. Every infinitesimally closed point like this. Then there is a natural way of defining these integral curves. Okay? How do you define that? You just write this Ka as equal to dxa by d lambda, where lambda is arbitrary. Then you integrate those equations, because Ka is given as functions of x, dxa by d lambda is a differential equation, you integrate. That will give you xa as a function of lambda, which is an integral curve to the vector field. Of course, if vectors start crossing or doing something crazy, this will, but normal photons will not behave like that. So, there will be a very well defined set of integral curves to these vector fields, and starting from this you can get to that. Alternatively, which is a simpler route most of the time we will take, we will assume that I have null geodesics and these null geodesics are affinely parameterized. Therefore, it satisfies this equation with the right hand side equal to 0, lambda is an affine parameter. Then I will work with that. So, again my original maxim still stands. If you do not think too deeply about it, it will work out. Okay? But if you start thinking about it, you better make sure you think it completely through. Okay? If you write the naivest possible thing, it will take care of itself. Okay. Incidentally, all these assumes that if I say a geodesic is null at one point, it will stay null everywhere. That is almost obvious, but you can try proving this, because you can take this quantity UBDB, which is the directional derivative, and act on UA. Then you will find that both the terms vanish. So, if it is a null geodesic, it will stay null all throughout. If it is a time-like geodesic, it will stay time-like, space-like, etc. This is not true about an arbitrary curve. If you are given an arbitrary curve, the curve can be space-like in one place and time-like in another place and null in between. It can meander through space-time in any way it likes, But if it is a geodesic, it cannot do that. It has to be null, space-like, or time-like. Okay. Now this is also a good time to mention the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which again we will use it only much later. But let me just mention it. When we did the variation of the action, there was a boundary term which we just ignored, but we could have played the same game and found it out. If you did all that properly, you will just get the standard equation which says that GAB d of the action with respect to DXA, d of the action with respect to DXB. This is like the momenta, so the square of the momenta should be equal to m square. This is the Hamilton-Jacobi equation in a curved space-time. So it is extremely simple, and it is, that is what it should be, because if it becomes eta AB, it gives you the special relativistic free particle. Now of course these things depend on x, so solving this is slightly non-trivial. Once you solve, you will get the action with a set of constants, and you differentiate those constants with respect to those constants, equate it to new constants, and the result which you get is going to give you the trajectories of the particles. Okay, so there are no surprises in that; it is straightforward. I want to next introduce one more variational principle, which is useful for several reasons, and which is closely related to this parameterizations we have been talking about. That is this. Suppose you look at an action, I should probably put a bar or something, compared to the previous ones which we have been discussing, which is integral GAB DXA by d lambda, DXB by d lambda, d lambda. This is very similar to the previous one. If I have put a square root over here, it is identical, but I am taking the square of that. And suppose I extremize this, okay, what will I get? Now extremization of this is trivial, because this is classical mechanics. This depends on x, these things are like velocities, think of lambda like time, okay. So this is your Lagrangian, lambda L dt, this is like dt. So then what you will get is, you will have first dl with respect to the coordinate, which is xi. So dl with respect to dxi, only this is going to contribute. So you will have di of something like gab. No, this is not at ds square, because I didn't tell you what lambda is. Okay. If lambda was proper time, it is ds square. But in general, it is just a parameter. Okay.
No, I am not getting what is the starting point.
Starting point is, I define an action in terms of a set of curves xa of lambda, where lambda is like a time, and this is just classical mechanics action. No. Okay. So then dl by di is going to pick up this term multiplied by this, which I will glibly call ua, because they are like velocities. Okay, then this should be equal to d by d lambda of dl with respect to the velocity. So there is a factor 2 there, that will give me a factor half here, times any one of them, which is g, let us say ib ub. So if I work that out, I get d by d lambda of ui is equal to half of di of gab ua ub. This is identical to the geodesic equation we first derived. If you go back and look at it, we had this covariant component of the 4 vector. On the right hand side, only the derivative with respect to that appeared. Remember, we even took g00 to be 1 plus 2 phi, that 2 and 2 cancelled out, this gave the gradient, and this was 00, all that sort of a thing. Okay, so this is exactly, this action gives you exactly the same geodesic equation as the action with a square root, provided this lambda is an affine parameter. Okay. Now, when we had that square root, we did not put any restriction on lambda. You could have taken any parameter you want, you would have in general got an equation like that. Okay. While in this particular case, you can do this, and for example, if you had assumed this to be S, it would have immediately given you the geodesic equation, etc. The reason I mentioned this is that very often this is the quickest route to compute the Christoffel symbols. See what is happening here, let me give you an example of this action. This is integral d lambda. Suppose I look at two dimensional sheet of paper in polar coordinates. Okay. Then GAB DXA DXB, I had to just put a d lambda on that. That will give me r dot square plus r square theta dot square. In 2D polar coordinates, where the dot refers to dr by d lambda. Okay. So, you do not have to work this through and then do anything, you can write it like this and then work out the component by component. I mean, you vary this, think of this as classical mechanics, then r dot and theta dot are like velocities, lambda is like time. So, you can immediately write down what are the quantities. And when you expand it out, they will all become d square r by d lambda square equal something, d square theta by d lambda square equal to something else, and you can read off the Christoffel symbols gammas. Okay. The advantage is that if you use the definition of Christoffel symbols in terms of the metric and compute it, in 4 dimension there are 40 of them to compute, many of them will turn out to be 0, at least in space times where you can do anything with, many of them will turn out to be 0. But when you do it like this, you pick out only non-zero ones, the zero ones just go away. Okay. So, this is an extremely good technique. Nowadays there exists lots of software packages like Mathematica, Maths Tensor, etc., which will compute all these things for you. But unless you are very familiar with it, or if it is just a simple problem in which you need to compute the Christoffel symbol, this is the quickest way to obtain that. Okay. So, here we are using ds square. Of course, there is a question as to why that gives you the same equations of motion as this. That is because if ds, if you have a Lagrangian and you take any arbitrary function of that Lagrangian, most of the times these things will agree with each other, not always, but most of the times it will agree, and ds and ds square belongs to that class where it agrees. Okay, you have to check it out explicitly in each of the cases. The problem is because of that d by d lambda term, because there will be an f, suppose you instead of l you use an f of l. Then that f will go and sit inside it, and when you are differentiating, you can get some non-trivial terms. They don't arise in this particular case. Okay, fine. The next thing which I want to do, going along the same lines, is to describe a little bit more of the geometrical features of the covariant derivative and several rules for computing covariant derivatives in different contexts. Because for the rest of our class, on several occasions you will have to work with covariant derivatives and you want to simplify them as much as possible. That is what I am going to do next. The general rule is that whatever you have been doing with ordinary derivatives in special relativity, we can now do with covariant derivatives, almost all. There are some notable exceptions which we will discuss when we are taking up curvature. So, in order to, we want to obtain expressions like divergence of a vector field and write down how to and find out how to express them in terms of the metric itself. So, these are all simple formulas, but you need to know them, and some of these it is good for you to memorize. So, I will indicate what they are, and to do that I want to first derive some preliminary results. One result is something which we had already derived, and I am just reminding you, is that we found that if G is the determinant of the metric tensor, delta G by G was GAB delta GAB. Okay, this we obtained long back. This is like the we use the relationship between log of the determinant and the trace of the log, and to obtain this. From this, it immediately follows that dI of G, that is just the derivative, I mean the determinant of the metric tensor is a function of coordinates. If I want dI of G, I just get this as G times GAB dI of G lower AB. Okay, this is one result which we will need. The next result which I need is slightly trickier. In order to get that, let me look at the quantity dI of GAB GBC. What do you think this is? Yeah, but you don't need to do that. What is GAB GBC? Is Kronecker delta, right? So is 1 or 0. So this is 0. And then you use Leibniz rule, because that is what I need to do something. So you write this, and this is equal to GAB dI of GBC. Okay, let me make it an implied sign. GAB dI of GBC equal to minus dI of GAB times GBC. The whole idea is I want to relate derivative of a contravariant G to derivative of the covariant G. Okay, that is what I am trying to do. So you got up to this. Now of course there is this unnecessary thing hanging around there. So in order to remove that, you multiply both sides by G something with that C, let us say GCK. So you multiply this also by GCK. You should learn this trick, because this is something and there is an extra GBC, we want to eliminate it. The usual trick is if this is a matrix, then you have to multiply by the inverse of the matrix. That is precisely what you are doing. And the fancy way of doing this is to watch out for this free index and contract on that free index and introduce a new free index. Okay? So this quantity is C is contracted. So this is just Kronecker delta on KB. So right hand side is minus dI of G, this B gets replaced by K, AK. Is that clear? You multiply by this quantity, C and C is contracted, this is Kronecker delta on K and B. So Kronecker delta on K and B will contract with this and will make it K. Therefore, you get the result that dI of G AK is equal to, the way to remember this is the following. You want to have dI of G AK, you start with a dI of, let us say, GBC, and I want to make this B and C go up. So you put a GBA, which is same as GAB here. And then you put a GCK, you have made them go up, but then you throw in a minus sign. You throw in a minus sign because we know that we got it from Leibniz rule. So it is essentially what you would have normally written by rising it, except for this minus sign. Okay? So these are the two results which we will repeatedly use in order to obtain several expressions. Okay. So let me try to get those expressions for you. The first result which I want is an expression. Okay, even before that, I want two more preliminary results. Let me obtain those two and then I'll come back to this. There is a simple expression you can write for gamma A I A. Okay? That expression essentially comes from this with the following notation. So let me just work this through. This equation can be made to write as dI of G divided by G is equal to GAB of dI of GAB. Now this G we know is a negative number, so it is much nicer to work with minus G. So you put a minus G here and you put a minus G here. Okay? So this is dI of something like log of this, correct? So if I put a half here and a half here, this left hand side can be thought of as dI of log root minus g. Because root minus g will give me, that root will give me a half, then minus g log derivative is going to be dI of this by this. So I get a relation that half of GAB dI of GAB, that is with a dI and GAB contracted, can be expressed in terms of this. Now let us work this out. This will be related to that. So let us see what this is. So this is half GA and I am going to get this with a K there. So I have a K in the lower covariant index place, so it is minus dk of gia, ia coming from this, plus di of gak plus da of gki. Okay? I have just written it out for this quantity. Now you see that this is symmetric in A and K. If you take this term, this is a K and a A, and here there is a A and a K. This is anti-symmetric. These two terms together are anti-symmetric in K and A. Therefore, when I contract with this, they will go away. Therefore, I can just cancel out these two terms. What I am left with is AK, AK contracted with a DI of G with a half. That is exactly this quantity. Half, these two are contracted with dI. Therefore, this is equal to dI of log root minus g. Okay? Now there is, so that means if you have a gamma with two indices together, it's very easy. You don't have to go around computing any of these things. You can, once you know the metric tensor, you can compute it. Now I want to get one more expression, which is a little bit more involved, but let us try to work it through. I want to look at the expression GAB gamma I AB and see what this is. Okay. So this is going to be again half GAB. There is a gamma I on top, so let me write it as gamma GI on top. I will introduce a K. So again, K is the lower index. So minus DK GAB plus DA GKB plus what is left? K is taken, A is taken. So DB of GAK. All right, now let us see what we can do with this. There is an AB term here and there is a BA term here. These two are essentially the same because I am contracting with this AB. Therefore, I can put a factor 2 here and wipe out one of them. All right. Now here I have a GIK and a GAB contraction with a factor half, which is a nice expression. I know what it is. Minus sign let us pull out. Then there is a half GIK also, let me keep here. It is GAB contracting with GAB with a derivative with respect to K. This is exactly this. So it is dK of log root minus d. Then I have the second term, which is half, and this 2 goes away. So you are left with GAB, GIK, DA of GKB. Let us stare at this. There is a B and I am rising it with respect to A. There is a K which I am rising with respect to I. So this whole thing is minus this DA, G. The risings are K goes to I and B goes to A, AI, by this rule. Okay? So this is also a fairly simple expression. So you plug that in and now you see something else. This is AA and an I is a free index. So let me make this also AA and I as the free index. Now this log root minus g is going to give me a derivative of root minus g and an 1 over root minus g. So let me write that also. Root minus g and derivative of root minus g. Okay? And in this let me put a root minus g. Correct? So this is just dA of square root of minus g times GIA inside. Is that clear? Fine. So this entire expression can be simplified to minus 1 over root minus g. The free index should be I. So it is, let us say, k root minus g g k I. So you know two particular combinations of gammas can be expressed entirely in terms of metric tensor. First is the one in which the a and a are contracted, then it can be expressed entirely in terms of log root minus g. The other is when AB is contracted out leaving a free index. That is a little bit more complicated and it is given by minus 1 over root minus g dk of that quantity left. This is what I need. Now let us work out various consequences of this. So first thing I want to do is to compute the quantity di or okay di of a vector AI. This is just a generalization of partial I AI, which is like the covariant divergence. Okay? We want to see what this comes out to be. So we know the definition for that. This is DI of AI plus, that is a correction term, which is gamma I J AJ. Just make sure you understand that. We are correcting for I index, so that gets replaced by this. Differentiating index is I, that goes here and I comes here. But now it is very simple. For this we have obtained an expression. So this is going to be di of AI plus AJ, and we have a I and a J. Goes to this, two of them are contracted, whatever remaining is the derivative of that quantity, which I will now write as 1 over root minus g dj of root minus g. So, same trick, you pull out a 1 over root minus g. So, this will pick up a root minus g. So, this is root minus g di of ai. The other one is this, you can replace by I again, instead of g you write I. Okay. So, this becomes 1 over root minus g di of root minus g ai. This is the expression for divergence in a space time which or a space which has gammas. So, again I want to connect up with something which you know. This has nothing to do with general relativity or any such thing, it is something which you have learned. For example, if you take the divergence of a vector in spherical polar coordinates, suppose you want to compute, I am just giving it as an example, if you want to do divergence of, let us say, a vector v in 3D in spherical polar coordinates, what you need to do there is to write 1 over root g, there is no minus, 3 dimension, so alpha root g a alpha. Okay. In spherical polar coordinate, this will become 1 upon r square sin theta d alpha r square sin theta a alpha. So, if you work it out, you will pick up when this quantity is r, sin theta comes out. So, you get 1 upon r square d by dr of r square ar, right. Then you get a term which involves theta. So, r square comes out now. So, you get 1 upon sin theta d by d theta sin theta a theta. Then finally, you have a phi and phi both of them comes out and you will end up getting d a phi by d phi, right. This is something which you should have known. Okay, this is something which you should have known from normal spherical polar coordinates and that just matches with this. So, the general expression for divergence is what is given here, and if root minus g is non-trivial, you can just throw it in to obtain this result. It is also important in a completely different context. In special relativity, we said that if I have an integral over d4x of di of ai will be equal to some integral, this is over some 4 volume, this is going to be integral over the boundary of that 4 volume d3x ai ni, right. This is valid in special relativity. This we have done several times, we have used it. Now, what is the corresponding generalization in general relativity? So, in general relativity, this should become a covariant expression. So, the d4x is not covariant, and we found very early on that root minus g d4x is the correct generalization. You remember, when d4x goes to d4x prime, there is a Jacobian which we expressed in terms of root minus g. So, the left hand side should become integral root minus g d4x. And they are also explained to you that this is no more complicated than putting r square sin theta dr d theta d phi kind of a term. So, this is the integral over this quantity. Then on the right hand side, or before going to the right hand side, there is this object with the most natural generalization is di of ai. This is the covariant derivative. Now, if you just look at this, I have told you long back that the Gauss theorem has, or Stokes theorem, any of these things has nothing to do with the transformation properties of the vectors. if you have dI of something, d by dx1 and a dx1 integration, then you can take the boundary terms. But you seem to run into a problem because there is a root minus g here, which is a function of space, while the derivatives are sitting here. This formula comes to your rescue. If you write this quantity in terms of this, so you use this result here, then this 1 over root minus g very nicely cancels with this root minus g, and you will end up getting integral d4x dI of something, dI of root minus g AI. Now you have reduced it to a previously solved problem and you can work everything out. Okay. More formally, the answer to this is written as integral over the boundary dV of, I will write it and then explain, I will put a root h d3x ni ai. This is exactly the same as this expression. The difference being, if you are sitting in a four-dimensional space-time, which is in general curved with an arbitrary metric GAB. Now suppose you look at a surface. The surface will also be in general curved. So the surface is defined as some function of xi is equal to 0. Okay. Then the normal to that surface is dI of f is equal to ni. Those definitions go through general relativity or special relativity because normals are local construct. So they should match with each other. Now once you have got that, you have a metric induced on the surface. Because if you take the full space-time metric and you restrict your DSS to the metric on the surface, you will get a metric induced on the surface. And that induced metric will have a determinant, which is root h. Okay? And that root h times d3x is the volume element of that space multiplied by AINI. Okay, that is all there is to it. The three-dimensional surface.
At that surface.
Because if the surface is crazy, then you have to take into account that. I mean, you can write down a formal expression for that, because suppose you take ds square. Ds square between any two events we know is gab, dxa, dxb. Right? Now, what is a surface? In order to define a surface, you would have given xa as a function of, let us say, xa of y1, y2, y3. Let us understand what this means. Xa's are four quantities, right? The three-dimensional surface which you are restricting should have only three coordinates. So you would have given xa in terms of y1, y2, y3, which are three parameters which define for you the surface. Therefore, in this, I could have written this as dxa by dy alpha, dxb by dy beta, dy alpha, dy beta. This is purely three-dimensional. So, this whole quantity is the metric which is induced on that surface. So if you give me the surface and you give me the full metric, I can write it down. This is what I would have called H alpha beta. Okay, and that H will have a determinant. So we play the same game in one dimension less. And then that H is root H is what sits there. Okay. So the divergence theorem which we have in special relativity goes through completely thanks to this, because of which these terms vanish correctly. Okay, fine. Now let us get to one more thing, which is very closely related to this. Suppose you have, you want to compute divergences of quantities with some special properties. And in particular, I have electromagnetism in the back of my mind. So AI can be thought of as vector potential. Then you would have liked to define an FIK. In special relativity, we defined FIK as dI of AK minus dK of AI. This is not covariant, so we would like to generalize this definition. So the generalization would be dI of AK minus dK of AI. Okay. Fortunately, you don't have to worry about this. You can actually put an equal to sign. You don't have to generalize. The reason has to do with the symmetries of the Christoffel symbols. When you work this out, dI of AK will have a dI of AK then minus gamma differentiating index. The index we are correcting is k, so k goes here, then let us say some m, am, right. Now when you subtract from this, this is fine, but this is ki and ki, they are symmetric. Therefore, the definition of field tensor does not pick up any corrections. So you could have just used the ordinary derivatives and you would have still got it because it is anti-symmetric. You are not so lucky about the next part, which is when you want to calculate the divergence of this, because again in special relativity we had the result that dI of FIK was 4 pi times JK, correct. Now how does this generalize? For that I have to generalize this quantity. So in order to generalize that, I need to work with dI of FIK. This takes a little bit of doing, so let us work it out. So this is the covariant derivative of a second rank antisymmetric tensor. So first you have a dI of FIK, then you have to add correction terms. So let us first, I will put a gamma and then f, and in an ik let us correct for I. So I put the I here, replace it by a dummy index and I keep the k here. Differentiating index is I and the dummy index goes here, okay. Then I have the another term which is again a gamma and a f. I corrected for I first, now I had to correct for k. So I remains as it is and I put a m here, then that m goes here, differentiating index is I and what is left I think is k is what we have. This I don't have to worry, FIM is anti-symmetric, this is symmetric, so that goes away, okay. So this term is 0. This I can work out again using what I have there, because this is gamma ii m. So this quantity is going to be dm of log root minus g, which is just 1 over root minus g dm of root minus g in this term. So now we are back to square one. We know exactly the same game which we have played before. This becomes 1 over root minus g dI of root minus g into FIK. So it is again nice and simple. So if you want to calculate the divergence of the term, which is a divergence of a tensor which is anti-symmetric, then you can use a formula which is very similar to what we had for a vector. Vector also had the same form for the same reason. So this is what you will have. Is that clear? Fine. So now you have to check whether everything which we thought of before, like the conservation law for J, etc., holds. So how would you do that? For example, suppose you take this equation. I mean, I have generalized this here, and we want to equate it to 4 pi times JK. This is Maxwell's equations in curved space time. So the Maxwell's equation in flat space time, we just generalize it by at going to every locally inertial, every point, go to a locally inertial frame, there the covariant derivatives become ordinary derivatives, and then using that I replace the ordinary derivatives by covariant derivative. Then I just turn around and say this is generally covariant, therefore it should take into account how gravity affects the Maxwell's equation. For example, bending of light or the interaction between electromagnetic waves and the gravitational field, all of them are included in this equation. You just have to give me the metric and then I can work it through. And this Fik I can write in terms of the vector potential using this relation. Of course, rising and lowering is now done with G. So there are two G's sitting here. When you define it like this and then work it through. But except for that, it is all done. But this is the equation which we have, which in turn means that dI of root minus g Fik is going to be 4 pi root minus g j superscript k, correct? Now suppose I take a decay of this. This is 0, root minus g does not matter because I am taking a derivative with this is symmetric and anti-symmetric contraction, it is 0. So that is going to be decay of root minus g jk, correct? It may not look like anything which you have seen, but if I divide this by 1 over root minus g, here I will pick up a 1 over root minus g, and this is nothing but 4 pi times covariant divergence of jk, which is now 0. So the way root minus g is cancelled is very beautiful. I mean, it will all take care of itself. So originally you had this equation and you just did a decay of this and said this is 0, therefore decay of jk is equal to 0. Here of course you have to put this root minus g in and the correct generalization is obtained. What about charge conservation? This is the charge conservation in a general space time, and that can be reduced to this. And when you are working out the Stokes theorem or Gauss theorem, you will multiply by a root minus g d4x. That root minus g will take away this, and what remains with this extra factor of root minus g will take care of everything. Again, let me stress, it has nothing to do with general relativity. If you have been writing down charge conservation in spherical polar coordinates, you will have to use this. The divergences has to have this root minus g. R square sin theta, which you write down, is just root minus g. So that is all which comes in, but the beauty of principle of equivalence is that what works in a non-inertial frame in a flat space time, to some extent, we will see where the exceptions are, will work in a curved space time, because curved space time is locally indistinguishable from an accelerated frame, and an accelerated frame is essentially a curvilinear coordinate system. Okay. So we have not only done the concept of how to generalize your derivatives, etc., we have also now by now worked out how gravity affects at least two of the systems. We know how our gravity affects particles. You just write down integral ds, where ds is square root of gab dxa dxb. They follow geodesics in a curved space time. We also now know how Maxwell's equations are affected by gravity. That is a big plus. We didn't have to do any extra work. Whatever we did in special relativity, we just borrowed all of them, changed ordinary derivatives to covariant derivatives, and d4x's to root minus g d4x. In fact, I could have written down the action itself in the same form. See, the action for the electromagnetic part, there is a free particle term, but the electromagnetic part of the action was minus integral d4x ak jk originally in special relativity. Then we had a minus 1 upon 16 pi integral d4x fik fik. Okay, this is what we had. All that you have to do is to add here, root minus g, and put a root minus g here. That's it. So this tells you how electromagnetic field couples to gravity, and this FIK should be contracted with a g. Similarly, this has to be contracted with a g. Somebody gives you this 4-vector and this 4-vector, and AK is related to FIK by this. Now, this needs to be understood. So, let me spend a little bit of time explaining the physics behind it. What we are trying to say is something very profound. Suppose you had a material particle of mass m and charge q, and we wanted to know how this charge couples to the electromagnetic field, or how the electromagnetic interactions affect particles. By and large, we wrote down a vector potential and coupled it through this, and then we worked the consequences out. Now, you would have thought something similar should happen in gravity. You start with minus m integral ds, then you couple particle of mass m to gravity, then you write down eventually an action for gravity alone like this term, and you work everything out. But because gravity is just geometry, you don't have to do any of that. You start with the postulate that all gravitational effects are geometrical. So if you can generalize whatever you did into a curved geometry, that is a correct description of gravity. Now, before you generalize into curved geometry, you first write down everything in curvilinear coordinates. This is something which you know because this is just tensor analysis. Then quietly you say that GAB, which was in curvilinear coordinates, is now a general metric in curved space-time, produced by some distribution of matter, which we will come to eventually. That tells you, if somebody gives me a GAB, how it affects any other material system, including an electromagnetic field. You can do the same thing for a scalar field. What will you get for a scalar field? Let me just mention it and then stop. So for a scalar field, in special relativity, we had dI, massless scalar field, equals 0, this kind of an equation. This was what we wrote as box phi, right? In curved space time, this has to become dI of phi equal to 0. But remember that dI of something, which is a vector, can be written as 1 over root minus g, dI root minus g times that vector, and that vector is dI with a thing on top. So it is good to write it as gik times the nabla with a k at the bottom, but the nabla k phi is just ordinary derivative. Therefore, this is just dk of phi. This is equal to 0. Once again, this is nothing but the Laplacian in the case of curvilinear coordinates. This is something which you have done hundreds of times. I mean, like del square, when you compute in Schrodinger equation, this is exactly the terms which you will have. This root minus g will be r sine square theta, and then you need to keep the gi case properly, and you will get exactly the same. So all that which you have learned, it has never been taught in this context, but these are essentially these. Okay, they come about, it is written down in some form. It comes about because first in curvilinear coordinate, the Christoffel symbols are non-vanishing. Therefore, ordinary derivatives has to be changed into covariant derivatives. And after you have changed it into covariant derivatives, there are correction terms involving gammas. Some special correction terms like the ones like this can be returned in terms of metric. Therefore, those formulas are true. Okay, but this is the correct way to approach it, but there are other tricks by which you can obtain this just looking at the metric, but this works in any space or any space time. Okay, I'll stop there. Then we need to do a little bit more about the derivatives of the symmetric tensors, etc., that I'll take up in the next lecture. Any time we'll have frequencies changing, light can bend, etc. All that is encoded in these equations. Now we want to understand how that happens. So the philosophy is that if you go to a point and you go to a freely falling frame there, then laws of special relativity is applicable there. Then you take the laws of special relativity there, where you can write down an action without this root minus g and rising and lowering with respect to etas. Okay? Then you want to write down these laws in a generally covariant way. For that, I have given you a prescription. Eta goes to g, d4x goes to d4x times root minus g, partial I goes to nabla I. So you just make those replacements. Once you have done these replacements, you are in curved space-time, and there is a background gravitational field, and how that gravitational field affects the propagation of electromagnetic waves, say, is already included in those equations. This doesn't happen anywhere else. I mean, there is a way of doing electromagnetism like this using gauge invariance, but it is not, I mean, one-tenth as beautiful as this. Okay, but here it flows out very naturally. Only thing it will not determine is explicit coupling to the curvature, which could all vanish in the locally inertial frame. So this goes under the philosophy something called minimal coupling. Okay, but that I will comment on more fully when we do the curvature proper. Okay, yeah. Anything else?